We celebrate Easter on April Fool's Day. In the last 100 years, the date of Easter has coincided with April Fool's Day 4 times. And this convergence will occur again in 2029 and 2040. I don't think most of us will be here by then, but a few will. There are several explanations for the origin of the day, but the one cited most often is that April Fool's Day began in the 1500s when the Gregorian calendar took over from the Julian calendar, making the new year begin on January 1st instead of the previous date of actually March the 25th. And then they celebrated the new year for a whole week to the 1st of April. Those who forgot the change and attempted to celebrate New Year's on the wrong date were teased as April Fools. Thus began the practice of playing good-natured pranks on this day. To the tradition of All Fools' Day persists in North America. Today, the tradition of All Fools' Day persists in North America as well as in most European countries, with many newspapers, radio, and TV stations and other media outlets taking part by publishing practical jokes. One of the most famous April Fool's pranks was broadcast on the BBC current affairs program Panorama in 1957, in which farmers were shown picking spaghetti from spaghetti trees during the spaghetti harvest in Switzerland. The BBC subsequently received a number of inquiries about the program from people requesting further information about spaghetti cultivation and how to grow spaghetti trees. In many respects, the resurrection of Jesus seems like the ultimate April Fool's joke. Who would believe that anyone could be dead and buried and then come alive again after 3 days? Is the resurrection any more or less believable than spaghetti growing on a tree? Then St. Augustine says this: "He departed from our sight that we might return to our heart and find him there. For he departed, and behold, he is here." There are lots of voices today that say, basically, that we who believe such a fantastic story are really, truly the fools. We believe in a God who listens to us. We believe in a God that we you know, say prayers to, and we expect to do things for us. Some people say that because we believe these things, that people who do pray, who believe in God, who have this sense of this divine being, are people who are too weak, mentally or spiritually, humanly speaking, to manage life. That we just can't hack it, so we have to have created this super being that we believe in, who listens to us, who does kindly things for us, who created the world and all of those things. But they very seldom talk about what it is, other than the fact that they don't believe in God, that what they believe human life is all about, and how they face death. Even very recently, you know, Stephen Hawking passed away, and he had several years ago reached the conclusion that the universe could have set itself in motion, and that all of these things that we have attributed to a divine cause just could have happened by some other means, so we really don't need a God to get this stuff going. It's okay to have one, but you don't really need one. And so more and more today, those words seem to resonate with more and more people. Who needs God? Who needs this being? Who needs any of this stuff? Maybe a nice story, you know, gives a little more color and excitement to the winter solstice and to the spring equinox, but otherwise, what's the big deal? I heard an interview on the radio of what was Easter to these various people. And almost everybody they interviewed said the first things that came out of their mouth were bunnies, eggs, chocolate, maybe spring. Eventually somebody said something about God, and the interviewer was almost shocked. But that isn't the case for all those of us who are here this morning. We're here because we believe something. And we believe more than something. We believe in someone. The one we believe in is the one who called us in his life by his words, by his actions, by his death on the cross for us, that what God wants for us, the real God, the true God, the God that lives, the God that exists, is that we, who are his beloved creation, should not be afraid of anything that life can throw at us. Because nothing has the power to take away what God has given to us. Not hatred, not violence, not death itself in any form can take life from us, the life that we as human beings have been called to enjoy, that we as human beings have been gifted with, unique among creation. We made in God's image and likeness are those called to share in that very life of God. And that very life of God is what Jesus won for us by his sacrificial death on the cross and by being raised by the Father's glory on the third day, showing that he wasn't just a resuscitated corpse like he had done for Lazarus when he called Lazarus out of the tomb, but he was all new. This was a new being, and that new being is the reflection to you and me of what it is that we are meant to become. But in the meantime, the life that you and I are called to live is a life that his death and resurrection sealed and made perfect for us to imitate. And so, where do we find resurrection in this world? We find resurrection, as St. Augustine said, first of all, in the presence of Christ in our hearts. Truly, he's risen, and then he ascended, and then he sent the Holy Spirit. But that doesn't mean that he is just up there, someplace, that he's also here within all of us who profess faith in him, who believe in him, who've been baptized into his death and resurrection. He's in us, alive, risen, victorious, calling us to be alive and risen and victorious over the power of sin and suffering, and at the end, over the power of death itself. We find that the resurrection in all kinds of places in the world where people finally forgive one another, begin to talk to one another, reconcile with each other, seek peace instead of continuing in war, where families reconcile, where people at last have a sense of peace, even as they journey towards the end of their lives, that they understand that this world isn't all there is to the program, that life is meant to be lived eternally with God, and that what makes that possible for us is what Christ did for us once on the cross and by being raised, and what he continues to do for you, for me, for everybody who professes faith in him, and even offers to those who reject him this chance to have life that's really life. Life that means something. Life that's lived for the good of somebody else and not just for myself. In other words, a life of love empowered by the one who is the epitome of love, who is the incarnation of love, who shows that love is ultimately stronger than death. Some people say we're fools for believing such things, that we're weak-minded because this is the only way we can make sense out of a hard, tough, cruel, cold, and cruel world. Well, so be it, that we be the fools of the world, because the foolishness of God seems to be truly the real wisdom of God. What seems foolish is really where the truth is. And that's why we are here today. Wherever we are on our faith journey, whether we feel strong in our faith or weak in our faith or even questioning in our faith or at some place in between, we're here to hear again this proclamation that Christ is risen. He is truly risen. That he has broken the power of sin and suffering and death over us. That he invites you and me to again be renewed in that faith, be renewed in his love, be renewed in his Holy Spirit, so that we can go forward into the rest of our year, into the rest of the days of our lives, understanding that the most important thing of all is to live our life in union with him, empowered by him, so that we can love, so that we can forgive, so that we can serve, so that we can manifest compassion and seek justice and live a peace that surpasses all understanding, that challenges the prevailing ideas and values of this world, that says that all that other stuff is one big fat lie, and that the truth is that love in Christ is what makes it ultimately possible to live the fullest, truest human life that there can be. We give thanks to God who created us and who more wonderfully redeemed us in the gift of his Son, Jesus Christ. And we give praise and thanks to the risen Lord himself with us today, present in all of us who profess faith in him, present in his holy word, and present in the sacrament of the altar that we will shortly participate in. We thank him for going all the way to the cross for us, so that we could have life everlasting.